Okay, so so basically we are discussing the 14th verse of the second chapter. So this is a very very important verse in the Gita. So this is discussing the topic of tolerance. So today's topic is called Art of Tolerance. So we'll read this verse. Matra sparshastu kaunteya shitoshna sukha dukkada agama apaino anityas tam titikshas sabharata. So Krishna is saying here, O son of Kunti, the non-permanent appearance of happiness and distress and their disappearance in due course are like the appearance and disappearance of winter and summer seasons. They arise from sense perception, O scion of Bharata, and one must learn to tolerate them without being disturbed. You know, Param Dayalu Prabhu was telling to do the word to word. So basically the word to word is Matra Sparshas. Matra Sparshas means, you all can keep yourselves muted. So Matra Sparshas means sensory perception. So Sparsha means touch. So Krishna is saying all the happiness and distress that we experience in this world is all due to our senses coming in touch with sense objects. Isn't it? Sparsha. Eyes come in touch with light. It's a sparsha. We experience something. You know, the light is soothing. We feel nice. The sight, if the light is hot, we feel it difficult, right? There is a sense of touch. If something soothing touches us, we feel good. If something burning touches us, we feel bad. So Matra Sparshas means sensory perception. Matra Sparshas tu Kaunteya. So Krishna is saying, O Kunti, Shitoshna Sukha Dukkada. Shita Ushna. Shita means winter. Ushna means summer. So Krishna is saying, just like one tolerates winter and one tolerates summer, right? Like right now it is the rainy season, or the rainy season is about to start, right? So when the rainy season is about to start, what can you do? Can you change the season? You cannot change the season. Therefore, you have to tolerate. Similarly, when there is Shita, when there is winter, right? In Goa, we don't experience that great, you know, severe winter. But in the north of India, there is very severe winter. But what can you do? Just tolerate. Ushna, heat. So when there is real hot summer, can you change it? You cannot change it. So Krishna's advice is tolerate. Shita, Ushna, Sukha, Dukkha, Da. Sukha means happiness. Dukkha means distress. And Da means giving. So Krishna is saying, just like the seasons come and go, there is winter, there is summer, the seasons come and go. Similarly, happiness and distress also come and go, like changes in the season. Agama apayino. Agama means appearing. Apayino means disappearing. So just like the winter appears, disappears. Summer appears, disappears. Similarly, Krishna is saying, distress will appear and disappear. Happiness will also appear and disappear. Anitya. So therefore, we have to understand that everything in this world is non-permanent, temporary. So what is Krishna's advice? Tams titikshas Bharata. So my dear Arjuna, O descendant of Bharata, so Srila Prabhupada writes in the purport, just like King Bharata is one of the forefathers in the dynasty of Arjuna. So the Lord is telling Arjuna, just like you had a very great forefather called Bharata, so similarly you belong in this dynasty. Therefore, you have to be, you have to maintain the dignity of this dynasty. Therefore, titikshasa, one must learn to tolerate. Tam titikshasa Bharata. So Krishna's translation is, as Prabhupada has translated here, one has to tolerate the appearance and disappearance of happiness and distress, just as one tolerates the appearance and disappearance of winter and summer seasons. Therefore, Krishna is telling one has to tolerate, my dear Arjuna. So, we are going to discuss a lot about this topic of tolerance. because this is one of the very important quality that we need to imbibe in life, right? Because so many things in life really are beyond our control. So therefore, the virtue of tolerance is very important. So just like Krishna is saying here, you know, not permanent, anitya. So everything in this world is anitya, temporary. Just like in the Bhagavatam, there is the story of Avanti Brahman. So Krishna is telling the story to Uddhava. So in the story of Avanti Brahman, Avanti Brahman was actually a very rich man, very respected. But suddenly, due to some reason, some people cheated him and he became a pauper. And because when he was very rich, he offended many people. So people started to take revenge when he became a pauper. And people started to criticize him, throw stones at him, urinate at him, you know, put him into difficult times. And Avanti Brahman was going through this two different experiences. One point in his life, he was really enjoying the most, respected the most, and suddenly he's put down. So when you go through different experiences, opposite experiences, you know, one after another, it confuses you. And in that confusion, people get depressed, people get very sad, and people actually break down. When Avanti Brahman was in this position of breaking down, he just couldn't handle it. At that point, Krishna gave him an inspiration within his heart. Avanti Brahman came to this conclusion that all the so-called happiness and enjoyment of this world is all due to our sense perception. It's all imagined. It's all in the mind. Because just like there's a saying in English, the mind can make heaven into hell and hell into heaven. It's all how we perceive things. So therefore, that's why Krishna is saying here, matra sparshas, sense perception. How our mind and senses perceive this world, that is how we are going to experience it. So if we don't have control of our mind, then we'll be suffering. Even having everything, we will suffer. Just like a few days ago was Narsingha Chaturdashi. So the Bhagavatam explains that Hiranyakashipu had everything in this world, right? He had the greatest control of demigods, practically everything he had. But still, he was unhappy and unsatisfied because his mind was not under control. But Prahlad Maharaj had nothing, practically nothing, right? Because the king was Hiranyakashipu, Prahlad is still a child. But he had inner control. He had control of his mind and senses. Therefore, Prahlad Maharaj was very satisfied and happy. So happiness is just not a product of what experiences, you know, our senses gather. It is a product of how much we can actually control the mind. Therefore, Krishna is using the word matra sparshas, sensory perception, because everything in this world is ultimately how we perceive it. So the word sparsha means touch, just like I told you. When our eyes come in touch with a form, or our skin comes in touch with an object, or a tongue comes in touch with an object, it's all sparsha, it's all touch. And because of that touch, we have different experiences. Heat, cold, good, bad, like that, right? So Krishna is also using the word here, agama apayino. Agama apayino means fleeting. That which passes, it comes and it goes. So in this world, everything is fleeting. It comes and it goes. Just like Radhanath Swami Maharaj, in his Journey Home book, he gives a very interesting thought, you know, a very interesting meditation. So the picture that you see is of, you know, the Himalayan regions, you know, Upper Rishikesh, Dev Prayag. So Maharaj was sitting in one of this is the Ganga flowing down, you know. So Maharaj was sitting in one of the rocks on the Ganga and meditating for almost a month on lessons that the Ganga is teaching. And every day Ganga would teach him so many different lessons. One of the lessons he learned from the Ganga was, he would look at the ripple formation, just like you can see in this picture. There, because the Ganga flows with a lot of force, there is ripple formation. And they are like beautiful designs that come in the water. And he observed that as soon as a design is made, it disappears. It appears and disappears, never to be formed again. Isn't it? These ripples will come and go. You can't catch it again. It's fleeting. just like, you know, the water that has passed away from where you're sitting, that water from the river cannot come back. It's gone, right? So that is the fleeting nature of this world. Or you look at the clouds, right? You will see a cloud right above your head, and you will see that the cloud has a design. You know, there is a design that appears, and very soon that design disappears. Right? It passes off. The wind takes it ahead, never to be seen again. A fresh set of cloud. So in this world, everything is passing. Happiness is passing. Distress is passing. Everything is actually passing away. There is nothing that is constant. Just like if you eat your favorite sweet, jalebi, right? You put that sweet in your mouth. How long does that sweet give you taste? For a few seconds. And then that taste disappears. Gone. Right? So if you have the ice cream, you know, there for some time, melts away in your tongue and it's gone. It's fleeting. So everything in this world is fleeting. So the best of food will just pass away. The taste don't last. Therefore, Krishna's suggestion here is tolerate dualities. So in this world, everything is in package of two. Just like there is heat, cold, honor, dishonor, happiness, distress, friend, enemy, right? Day, night. So everything is in package of two in this world. That is why this world is called a place of duality, dvandva. So how do you tolerate duality? By focusing on your responsibility, by focusing on your duty and continuing on your responsibility with integrity. Just like Srila Prabhupada in this purport gives two examples. Like a housewife, an Indian housewife, does cooking every day, isn't it? She has to go to the kitchen every day to cook for the family. Even if it is winter, she goes. Even if it is summer and the kitchen is hot, still it goes on. Just like, you know, in our Sharam Ashram here, we have a kitchen, you know, on the ground floor. And there we have like a roof that gets very hot inside, you know. So in the summer season, first of all, it's hot here and the kitchen gets so hot. So our devotees who cook here, it gets very difficult for them. But then what do? Service has to go on. Bhoga has to be offered to the Lord. So you just continue. Srila Prabhupada gives another example. Like every person is supposed to take bath in the morning. At least this is Indian culture. The Western culture is you take bath or probably don't even take bath. Just apply a perfume and you're done. But in Indian culture, you take bath every day in the morning. So if it is hot, right, it's good. You have a cold bath. But even if it's cold in India, people would still take bath in cold waters. You still take bath. Because we have to continue on our responsibility. So why is Krishna telling this to Arjuna? Krishna is telling this to Arjuna. You have fought many wars before. In all those wars before, whom you are fighting were your own enemies. So you fought that war. Now because you have to fight with your opposite party who are not your enemies now but your relatives, you are running away. This is not correct. You have fought many wars before. This war also you have to fight. You can't just run away because these are your relatives. No, you can't do that. You have to tolerate. You have to tolerate. This is part of life. You can't avoid it. Just like this COVID period, so many doctors are going out. So many things are happening, right? Because everyone's duty has to go on. You can't stop. Life can't stop, right? So you have to tolerate those dualities and go on. So something interesting, actually this is a very long topic. You know, there are many things to discuss on this. But we'll try to discuss as much as we can. So we all know that we have to tolerate difficulties. You know, when difficulties comes, calamities come in life, we have to tolerate. But what does Krishna mean by tolerate happiness? Do we have to tolerate happiness? Like someone gives you an ice cream and tells you, tolerate this ice cream. What is there to tolerate? You enjoy that ice cream, correct? If someone gives you a promotion and then someone tells you, are you tolerating the promotion? No one tolerates the promotion. You enjoy the promotion. So what does Krishna mean by tolerate happiness? That means when happiness comes, if it enters our head too much and we get proud of it, then what happens? We don't focus on our duty. See, why is distress a problem? distress or difficulty is a problem because when we get overwhelmed with it, you know, it overpowers us and we are not able to focus on our duty. So similarly, when happiness also gets too much into our head, right, and we become proud, or because of happiness, success, we become complacent, then we don't focus on our duty. So therefore, it's important that come what may, we need to focus on our duties. Just like Lord Ram, the perfect example of this balance, right? In his life also, he saw extremes. You know, one day he was supposed to be coronated the king of Ayodhya. The day Dasharath Maharaj told Lord Ram this, Lord Ram didn't get too elated. He didn't say, let's celebrate. He knew that next day morning is supposed to be coronated. That day night, what did Lord Ram do? Lord Ram, the entire night, he fasted along with Mother Sita and they were doing yajna, right? And they were doing tapasya, because Lord Ram was thinking, the throne, the kingship that I'm getting is not for my enjoyment. It is a responsibility so that I can serve. So because he took it in that spirit, he focused on his service. Therefore, when he got this news, this good news that he's supposed to be coronated, he didn't become too elated. He remained equipoised. He remained equipoised, right? Similarly, the next day morning, when Lord Ram goes to the court of Dasharath Maharaj, that is the time he hears the news that he's supposed to go to the forest for 14 years. You know, he is abandoned in the forest for 14 years, right? Exiled there. How did Lord Ram take it? He was not distressed. He didn't go into depression. What's happening, you know? Y'all can't do this with me. No, Lord Ram took it in a stride because he thought, yeah, this is the nature of this world. You can expect it, right? So in this world, both these things are expected. Just like you have a coin. In a coin, there is head and there is tail also. You can't say, I want only head. I don't want tail. Not possible. If you want a coin, you will get the head, you will get the tail also. So similarly, in this world, you can't say, I want only happiness in this world. No, you will get distress also, right? So it's both sides. You can't avoid it. Just like in the Bhagavatam, you have the story of Chitraketu Maharaj. Chitraketu Maharaj, he was very depressed because he didn't have a son. He married 1 lakh wives, the Bhagavatam explains, and he still didn't have a son. Very depressed, very depressed. So Narad Muni comes to him and asks him, what is your problem? He tells Narad Muni, I don't have a son. So Narad Muni tells him, theek hai, I will help you, you know, I will give you blessing that you will get a son. But then once you get this son, you have to name him Harsha Shok. Harsha means happiness, Shok means misery. So you have to name the son Harsha Shok. Combination of happiness and misery. So everything in this world is Harsha Shok. Gives you happiness, gives you misery. You can't say it will only give you happiness. And you can't say it will only give you distress. It will give you a mixture of both. So Chitraketu Maharaj agreed. He got a son, became very happy. The son gave him Harsha. But very soon, the other wives, so he got a son from one of the wives, and the other wives poisoned this son and killed this boy. So, and the boy died. Imagine, it was his only desire to get the son, a child. And as soon as the son, child is born, the child is dead. Right? He became very miserable. He started to lament, shok. So this is the nature of this world. You can't get one without the other. You know, both are a package. So the next day in the morning, Lord Ram is cursed and is abandoned to the exiled to the forest for 14 years. But Lord Ram is okay with it. He tolerates that also because he understands this is the nature of this world. So similar, therefore, Krishna is saying here, one has to learn this virtue of tolerance. One has to tolerate duality by realizing that everything in this world is temporary. So three principles, how do you tolerate duality? The first principle is to realize that this world means a place where there is going to be misery. Therefore, Krishna says, Dukkhalayam Ashashvatam, temporary and miserable. Right? Like Gaurang Prabhu, you know, he tells a story. One time in our ISKCON temple, somewhere in the West, you know, they made a huge cake for Govardhan Puja. So generally for Govardhan Puja, devotees make like a huge boga, annakoot, you know, they have parikrama of the annakoot and then devotees honor the prasad. So in this particular temple, the entire Govardhan was made of a cake, you know, a cake was made, you know, like a Govardhan, chocolate cake. So devotees were doing parikrama, aarti of Govardhan, everything. But everyone wanted that Mahaprasad. Everyone wanted to eat that carob cake, basically. So when that cake came in everyone's plate, everyone started to eat the cake. So they put the cake in their mouth and it was salty. They changed the cake, the side of the cake, and tried to eat it. Again, salty. Because they were thinking that if we just change the side, the cake is going to become sweet. But the cook who made the cake, instead of sugar, he put salt in the cake. So similarly, this world, it may look like a very attractive cake, a carob cake. It looked very attractive, a chocolate cake. But Krishna, who's the cook, who's made this cake, instead of sugar, he's put salt in this cake. Therefore, whatever we try, this cake is going to be miserable only. So that is the nature of this world. So when calamities, when difficulties come in life, or when dualities come in life, how do you tolerate? First, realizing that this is the nature of this world. The nature of this world is, it is going to come. So therefore, when you expect some trouble to come, you are okay with it. Because you understand, ye hone wala hi hai. Like today morning only, someone was telling me that, you know, there is so much ecological problem going on, COVID crisis going on. What is happening in this world now? What's going on? Right. So I told her that this is the nature of this world. What can you do? And especially Kali Yuga, these are the times when these things are going to happen. Definitely we try our best to stop it, avoid it. But then certain things are beyond our control. So therefore, we just need to tolerate. So the first step in tolerating duality is to realize the nature of the world. Second is to reconcile that everything in this world is temporary. It is going to pass off. Nothing is going to remain permanent. Just like one time there was a king. The king told all the prisoners of his kingdom that if you all give me something that will make me sad when I'm happy and happy when I'm sad, I will leave you, I will free you. So all the prisoners were thinking, what is that thing that will make the king happy when he's sad and sad when he's happy? So finally, there was one wise old man. He gave the king a ring. And on that ring, it was written, this will pass away. So when the king would become sad, he would look at that ring and understand, this will pass away. He would see those words. And when he was happy, he would look at that ring and he will understand that this will pass away. So everything in this world is going to pass away. Nothing is going to last forever. Our success will not last forever. Our failure will not last forever. Our happiness will not last forever. Our sadness will not last forever. Right? So everything in this world is going to pass away. So when we go through difficult times also, we can understand that this is going to pass away. This COVID phase will pass away. It's not going to remain eternally there. Right? So this helps us tolerate duality. The third principle is to repent. The first is to realize that the nature of this world is suffering. The second principle is to reconcile that things in this world will pass away. The third principle is to repent that because we have come in this material world, that is why we are suffering. That is why we are going through this duality, dvandva, right? Because we came, we left God in the spiritual world and came to this world. Therefore, we have to see all this drama going on, right? So when we go through sufferings like this, it can be a message for us that Krishna is telling us, come back to me. Because we have come in this world, we are going through all these issues. So it can be an opportunity for us to turn to God. Just like in our Journey of Self-Discovery course, we gave this example. Just like a girl, you know, she goes to the kitchen and very adamantly tells the mother that I also want to cook. The mother knows that the girl can't cook. So she goes to the market and buys a kitchen set for the girl. And then the girl is happy, busy, you know, trying her stuff, trying to do her so-called cooking. But then when she gets hungry, she realizes that her cooking is not going to satisfy her. She goes running to the mother. So similarly, all of us, we are like this little girl. We are trying to tell God, God, why only you should be the enjoyer? Why only you should be the controller? I will also control. I will also enjoy. So Krishna makes this toy, this material world for us. You know, go and try to enjoy, try to control. But just like this girl who is busy for some time because she's thinking that I'm doing something because I'm moving some vessels, I'm doing something. But after some time, she realizes that I'm only doing something, but what I'm doing is not going to satisfy me. It's not going to feed my hunger. Similarly, we come in this world and we try to play around nature to some extent. But down the line, we realize that this cannot satisfy the hunger of our heart. And that is the time we sincerely repent and turn to God. So there are these three points that can help us tolerate duality. First is to recognize the nature of this world, that this place is a place of suffering. So when suffering comes, it's natural. What else you can expect in this world? The second is to reconcile the fact that even if suffering comes, it is going to pass away. Everything is a passing phase. And the third principle is to repent, that because we made that original mistake of coming to this world, therefore we have to go through all this duality. And the hope for us is when we sincerely repent and we turn towards God, we can actually make this journey away from here. So in this way, we can actually tolerate the different dualities that come, right? So tolerating also means, just like we have to tolerate happiness and distress, similarly, one needs to tolerate honor and dishonor, right? So in this world, it's not that you will be honored always. You'll be honored sometimes, you'll be dishonored sometimes, right? What can you do as the nature of this world? Just like in the Bhagavatam, you have the story of Vidura. You know, Vidura is such a great soul. He is Yamaraj himself who comes as Vidura. Yamaraj is Dharmaraj basically. So Vidura was one of the most intelligent persons in the Mahabharata. Always giving the best advice. You know, the perfect advice. The Pandavas, after Krishna, they trusted Vidura the most. But Vidura also, such a great soul, was insulted, dishonored. He was trying his best to help the Kuru dynasty, to give advice to Dhritarashtra, to Duryodhan. But what did Duryodhan do? Duryodhan dishonored Vidura like anything. Duryodhan told Vidura, you are a son of a Shudrani. You are supposed to be our servants. You are eating our salt and trying to make hole in the same plate. Get out. You are a dog in our house. This is Duryodhan telling Vidura. But how does Vidura take it? Vidura doesn't tell Duryodhan, who are you? Vidura is telling, he's thinking himself, good. Krishna's mercy. So a devotee, whatever happens in his life, he thinks this to be Krishna's mercy. Tatteyanu kampa sumikshamano bunjana evatma kritam vipakam ridva vapubir vidadhan namaste jivet yo mukti sadai bhag. So this is Brahmaji's prayer in the Bhagavatam. So Brahmaji says, Tatteyanu kampa sumikshamano. So when devotees go through honor or to dishonor or through difficult times, devotees see that this is the mercy of Krishna. And they offer respects to Krishna and thank Krishna. And think that Krishna is sending this for their own purification. And they use this as a medium to surrender to Krishna. So Vidura thought that this is good. Dishonor is good. Because of this dishonor, I will actually able to leave this kingdom. I can get rid of all this politics and do Tirthyatra and surrender to Krishna. So he took this as an opportunity. So when difficulties come in life, we can see that these are opportunities. Like in English, there's a saying, failures are stepping stones to success. Right? So when difficulties, dishonor comes, failures comes, we can see that they are stepping stones. These are opportunities for us to surrender to Krishna more. Like I told you in the starting, the story of Avanti Brahman. When Avanti Brahman was dishonored, people started abusing him, you know, beating him, you know, doing all sorts of things with him. Avanti Brahman thought, good, now I can be humble. Because if everyone keeps honoring us, how will we be humble? So when dishonor comes, we will become humble. Just like devotees many times do book distribution, go house to house, distribute books. In some house, you are called inside, welcomed, you know, they'll give you water, you know. In some places, they may even touch your feet that you're doing service to God. But in some places, they will just shut the door on your face, or they will abuse you and tell you, find a job, you know, do something better, insult you and send you away. So in life, everything comes. Just like in the Krishna Leela, when Krishna and the cowherd boys are hungry one day, and the cowherd boys turn to Krishna and tell Krishna, Krishna, we are hungry, do something for us. So Krishna tells them, nearby the brahmanas, there are some brahmanas who are doing a yajna, so they have a lot of food. Why don't you go and ask them? Why don't you beg something from them? So the boys go and tell the brahmanas that Krishna and Balaram are hungry. Please give them food. So the brahmanas tell them, get out, we are busy, don't disturb us. So the boys come dejected to Krishna and tell Krishna, Krishna, failure, we didn't get anything. So Krishna says, don't worry, don't get dejected. Because in the begging profession, this thing will happen. One day you will get, one day you will not get. Don't give up hope. So Krishna tells, go to the wives of the brahmana. They are my devotees, they will give you. So the point is, Krishna is teaching us, life is like this. Sometimes you will get honor, sometimes dishonor, sometimes success, sometimes failure. But in all situations, we should see that these are opportunities to serve Krishna. So when we get success, when we get money, we can think that, or when we get fame and honor, we can think that Krishna is giving me this. Let me use this in Krishna's service. Let me use the money and facility in Krishna's service. And when Krishna takes away things from us, when we are dishonored, we can think that fine, Krishna has broken my attachments. No problem. Like Srila Prabhupada, before he started ISKCON, Prabhupada was running in his grihastha life, he was running a business, you know, called Bose Laboratories. Very successful business. And suddenly it so happened that the entire business collapsed. So Prabhupada took it as Krishna's arrangement. That Krishna has taken everything away. Krishna is telling me to surrender. Right? So no problem, he'll surrender. Right? So whatever the situation is, we have to see that it's an opportunity for us to surrender to Krishna. That's what the Bhagavatam teaches us. That's what the scriptures teach us. Just like the example of Prahlad Maharaj, he went through so many problems, but he saw everything as an opportunity to surrender to Krishna. And then finally, when his father was killed by Narsingdev and he became a king, still he continued his service to Krishna. No problem, whatever comes, right? So in this way, we can tolerate honor and dishonor. We can tolerate these dualities that keep coming to us. So Srila Prabhupada in one place in the in one of his purports gives the definition of what is greatness. Very beautiful definition. So Prabhupada says, greatness of a man is estimated by his ability to tolerate provoking situations. The greatness of a man is estimated by his ability to tolerate provoking situations. And in this world, there is always provoking situations that keep coming. Just like one of a big provoking situation is criticism. When people criticize us, you know, when people call ill names to us, that what you're doing is all useless, you're fit for nothing. So criticism is very difficult to tolerate. You may be able to tolerate happiness, distress, but tolerating feedbacks and criticism is not that easy. Very, very difficult when someone gives us a feedback straight at our face, right? If you have 100 people glorifying you, one person who comes and tells you that you look shabby, you know, you look most dirtiest person, you are fit for nothing, whatever they call you, our entire night will keep focusing on that. So we need to, how do we tolerate criticism? First thing, by understanding that, seeing that probably there is some indication for us how to improve ourselves, right? So instead of defending when we get criticized, we can think that might be there is some truth in it. Let me try to improve myself. So instead of trying to prove who we are, we focus on improving ourselves, right? Good, I've got this feedback. I can improve myself now. I can become better. And even if that feedback, the criticism that someone is giving us, even if it is not correct, what they are saying is completely false, we can still see it as that it Krishna is giving us this criticism through this person so that I can be more careful in future. Just like one of our disciples of Srila Prabhupada, Satswarup Maharaj, a very senior devotee of Srila Prabhupada, one day he was sitting in one of our temples and chanting. And one young American, not even a devotee, he tapped the back of Maharaj and told him, "You are not chanting correctly, chant properly." Who's telling this? A non-devotee is telling one sannyasi in ISKCON. But how did Maharaj take this? You know, Maharaj didn't think, who is this guy who's telling me? Maharaj thought that probably Krishna is telling me to be more careful when I'm chanting. Probably I'm chanting properly, but he's telling me to be careful so that I keep continue to chant properly. And the result of this introspection of this criticism, Maharaj wrote a book called Japa Reform Notebook. And this whole notebook, this whole book came into print because he took this criticism in a positive way. Therefore, Chanakyam Pandit says that one should have a neighbor who is always critical of you. Just like in politics, you have a ruling party and you have an opposing party that keeps criticizing the ruling party. So when criticism comes, instead of seeing that he's pulling me down, you should tell that he's keeping a check on me so that I can remain on the right track. That's the whole understanding of an opposing party. Right? And the third principle to deal with criticism is to see that it is an opportunity for me to take shelter of Krishna. Because the point that someone is telling you something, that means, or if someone is criticizing you, someone is speaking negative about you, that means you have probably done something to that person and that karma is coming back to you. Isn't it? So if we defend back, if we fight back, then the cycle of karma continues. Therefore, you just tolerate. Just like in Chaitanya Leela, in the life of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Ramachandra Puri, who was actually almost like a guru to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he would come to Jagannath Puri every day and he would come to the place where Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was staying in Gambira. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was a very strict sannyasi. But Ramachandra Puri would see a lot of ants around the room of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And he would criticize Lord Chaitanya saying that you are eating sweets. You are a sannyasi and you are eating sweets in private. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was not even doing this. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu didn't tell him, who are you? How can you tell this to me? How did Chaitanya Mahaprabhu take it? How did he respond? He thought that this is my guru, almost like my guru. My guru's god brother, he is correcting me so that I can remain on track. He is my well-wisher. He took it in that spirit. So when someone criticizes us, instead of seeing them as our enemy, we can try to see them as our well-wisher. They are actually trying to correct us and protect us. We can take it in that positive spirit. So in this way, we can actually deal with criticism. So therefore, Srila Prabhupada defined greatness as one's ability to tolerate provoking situations. Long back I had read a very interesting, something like a poem by Mother Teresa. It's very interesting, So she says, people are often irrational, self-centered. Forgive them anyway. So if you are kind, people may accuse you of selfish motives. Be kind anyway. So she's saying here that people are very self-centered. And when you try to be kind, people may think that you have some selfish motive. And people may be unkind to you. So therefore, she's still telling us be kind. Because many times we are in this tit-for-tat mode, correct? So we be kind to people, but when that person becomes unkind to us, we also become unkind to him. But she's telling here that even if others are unkind to you, you still remain kind. Be kind anyway. If you are successful, you will find some unfaithful friends and some genuine enemies. Succeed anyway. So even when you become successful in life, you will find some people envious of you and want to pull you down. But still, we should continue to remain successful. We should march on this path of success. If you are honest and sincere, people may deceive you. Be honest and sincere anyway. So if you are honest and sincere, you may have some people who may cheat you. And when they cheat you, you may think that let me also cheat them. But she's saying, no, you be honest anyway. You be sincere anyway. What you spend years creating, others could destroy it overnight. Create anyway. You know, if you work very hard for some project or something and you create it, someone may come and just destroy it. But still, don't get depressed. You know, don't get frustrated. Keep doing what you're supposed to do. If you find serenity and happiness some way, some may be jealous, but be happy anyway. So if you become happy also, you may have people who are jealous, but still we should be happy. The good you do today will be often forgotten, but do good anyway. So whatever little good we do may not make so much difference. Like, just like I was telling you, today morning someone was chatting with me and someone was telling me that, you know, India is going through such ecological crisis. All the Himalayan mountains all the trees are being cut, you know. And there was one person who actually struggled very much for this. And he was trying to fight court cases and everything. And that person has died, but still felling of trees is going on. So she was telling me that, what should we do? So this is the principle. We need to do our good. We need to keep doing good. It may not be enough. Therefore, she says, give the best you have and it will never be enough. But give your best anyway. Even the best we give may not be enough to change the world. But still, we have to keep doing our duty. The next line she says is something that's very important to meditate on. In the final analysis, it is between God and you. It was never between you and them anyway. So when we remain kind to people who are unkind to us, right? So when we keep doing good to others, even though others may not do good to us, when we remain honest, if others cheat us, when we keep doing these things, we should understand that ultimately why we are doing it, we are not doing it to just satisfy the people of this world. We are doing it to please God. Therefore, Krishna, we will see in the next verse, when we do it the next week, Krishna says, when we continue to tolerate in this way, when we keep moving on this great path of tolerance, right? Like Mother Teresa ends here, in the final analysis, it is between God and you. It was never between you and them anyway. So when we keep trying to serve God selflessly, Krishna explains in text 15, the result is we can achieve liberation. So therefore, the result of tolerance, of living a life of tolerance, is we can actually achieve liberation, you know, from this world of birth and death. So therefore, we need to tolerate. Just like Chaitanya Mahaprabhu tells this shloka, Trinadapi Sunijena Taroreva Sahishnuna Amanina Manadena Kirtaniya Sadahari. One should be more humble than a blade of grass and more tolerant than a tree. So why does Chaitanya Mahaprabhu use Taroreva Sahishnuna? Why does he say one has to learn tolerance from a tree? Because a tree, you know, it just stays put, whatever the situation is. If it's raining heavily, you know, it just stays there tolerating it. Scorching heat just stays there tolerating it. Cold winter just stays there and it keeps doing its duty, right? When it's time for it to give leaves, it gives leaves. When it's time for it to give flowers, it gives. And when it's no longer useful, it gives itself only. The wood only of the tree is used, right? So the point is living a life of tolerance, living a life of service to others. Like in the Bhagavatam, you have this beautiful story of Rantidev. King Rantidev was a very powerful ruler who did a long fast. Right? He did a fast for almost like 48 days for the welfare of his citizens. And when it was time for him to break his fast, he was just about to eat that food. One beggar came there, right, from a low family, and told Rantidev that I'm hungry, give me food. So Rantidev gave him half the food, right? And he was about to eat there was a mlecha, a chandala, who came with his dogs, a pack of dogs, and told Rantidev, my dogs are hungry. Can you imagine? My dogs are hungry. So Rantidev gave that food to the dogs, and he was about to drink some water there was someone else who came there and told Ranthidev that I am thirsty. Ranthidev gave that water also to that person, and Ranthidev, in great bliss, you know, with great faith, he was thanking the Lord that I have got an opportunity to serve others, and in this way my life will become perfect. So he tolerated hunger and thirst also in the service of others. It's like a tree. A tree is cut off completely, but the tree just tolerates. You know, the tree gives shade to a person, and that same person may cut the tree, but the tree tolerates and still keeps continuing to do good. So one should learn tolerance from a tree. That is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's suggestion. Two sutras to develop tolerance. How do you develop tolerance? First, strive to purify our consciousness of the six vices. So genuine tolerance comes with purity. The more the purity, the more one can tolerate. Right? So tolerance is not something material. One cannot get it artificially. It is the natural byproduct of a pure heart. Someone who has a pure heart is naturally very tolerant. If you see great souls, if you see the life of Sudama, if you see the life of Haridas Thakur, naturally very tolerant, tolerated so much. Haridas Thakur was criticized, Haridas Thakur was beaten in 24 marketplaces, tolerated, right? And even when Haridas Thakur was glorified, you know, and honored, he didn't take that honor seriously, right? He just tolerated everything that came in his life, right? Why? Because he was completely pure. His consciousness was pure. And how did he make his consciousness pure? By performing bhakti and by chanting Hare Krishna. So the virtue of tolerance just doesn't come like that. Even to get this virtue, one needs the mercy of Krishna. One has to beg Krishna to give us this virtue. And when we get that virtue, we can actually please Krishna all the more. So the first principle to develop tolerance is we need to purify our heart. And second is the small situations that keep coming in life, with our intelligence and commitment, we need to tolerate, right? You know, and situations keep coming. One after another keeps coming. Like you have this COVID phase now, you know, so many situations keep coming. What can you do? You don't have any option but to tolerate. And by tolerating, we become strong. Just like one time, there was one man who was walking on the road, and in between he saw a huge rock, a huge boulder. And that time God came and told him, push the boulder, push this rock. So this man thought, it is God's order, let me push this rock. He started to push. For 1 week, 10 days, he was pushing. But that rock was not moving only. So after 10 days, he became very frustrated. God came in front of him. And the man said, God, what kind of instruction you gave me? I pushed this rock, but this rock is not moving. So God told this person, I only told you to push this rock. I didn't tell you to move this rock. So you may think that nothing has happened, but look at your muscles. Your muscles have become strong. So similarly, when we keep tolerating difficult situations, when we keep pushing on and on, despite all the obstacles, when we keep going on and on, we develop strength in life, right? We develop, our muscles actually become strong. Another very important principle of tolerance is we need to learn to tolerate people. Right? Tolerating people is the most difficult. Why? Because everyone is different. And we need to learn to live with these differences. Right? So everyone is unique. Right? So no one in this world is ultimately perfect, isn't it? Other than God, no one else is perfect. So everyone has imperfections. So we need to live with people's imperfections. So how do you tolerate people? First principle is to focus on the good that they have. Everyone may have good and bad. We need to focus on the good in people. Even if it is little, if you focus on that, we will be a little more peaceful. But if you focus on the bad, you know, the negative part in people, it will be very difficult. There will be a lot of misunderstandings and fights. The second is we need to neglect their weakness. We need to let go of their weakness. Because generally, when you start staying with someone for a long time, you are exposed to their weakness also. Right? So you need to learn to let go of their weakness and neglect their weakness. And the third principle is one should cultivate positive appreciation. Find something that is genuinely good in that person and say it, appreciate it. When we do that, we can actually happily live with people, because staying with people is the most difficult thing. It's the most difficult test of tolerance, because everyone has different idiosyncrasies, you know, different styles of functioning, different ways of thinking, right, different speeds of working. So many differences are there, but we need to tolerate and live with it. And through this, our purification happens. One time, one devotee came to Srila Prabhupada and told Srila Prabhupada that, "Prabhupada, in your ISKCON, there are so many problems. You know, devotees also keep fighting and so many issues." So Prabhupada told this devotee, if you are in a ship, and in the ship, you have some problem with the inmates in the ship, you know, those who are in the ship along with you. So what will you do? Will you jump out of the ship? No, stay in the ship. Because what can you do? What option you have? If you jump out of the ship, that there is problem here, let me jump out. There is a bigger problem there. You will drown and die. So similarly, ISKCON, there may be some problems. There may be differences, you know, there may be real struggles. But then if you leave the spiritual life and try to jump out of it into material life, it's all the more problematic. So we need to tolerate. And when we keep practicing bhakti and tolerating devotees and tolerating people, when we actually reach, when the ship reaches the spiritual world, then everything will be all right. Then everything will be perfect. Till then, we need to tolerate. Another very important principle in this verse is, you see, Krishna is not giving false hopes. Krishna is not telling Arjuna, "My dear Arjuna, you surrender unto me. After that, you will not have any problems in life." Krishna is not saying that. What is Krishna telling Arjuna? There will be problems in your life. You have to learn to tolerate them. Don't ask me a life free from problems. Ask me the strength to face the problems. So no devotee prays to Krishna, "Krishna, don't give me problems." Devotee prays to Krishna, "Krishna, if you are giving me problems, please give me the strength to fight with these problems, to deal with these problems." Just like the example is given, a person who makes a lock always makes a key. There is no lock that is made without a key. Similarly, there is no problem without a solution. So our prayer to God is not, "God, don't give me problems." Our prayer to God is, "God, give me the strength to deal with the problems." And especially when we are in that devotee circle, and when there is fights also, the struggle also, we need to see that higher principle, that I need to tolerate this for a greater cause. For a greater cause, I need to tolerate. So why should we tolerate? For the pleasure of Guru and Krishna. So by tolerating, Guru and Krishna are pleased. So it may be difficult, we need to tolerate. Just like, you know, you have this beautiful story of Krishna and Sudama in their childhood. You know, when they were going out to the forest to get wood for their guru, Sandipani Muni, and there was forest, there was a storm and thunder and rains. And Krishna and Sudama were small children, and the guru couldn't come to help them. So both of them caught hold of each other's arms, and they tolerated that weather. And because they tolerated for the pleasure of Guru, the Guru became very happy. Because they continued on the mission of their Guru and they kept their relationship with each other. So similarly, in a spiritual movement, when you tolerate devotees, when you stay with devotees and keep pushing on this movement, you know, whatever difficulties come, you know, when you keep tolerating and keep moving on, we can actually achieve success and please Krishna. So we should tolerate, because we remember the mission of life. The mission of life is to achieve something higher in life. Just like one time, there was a person who went to the Middle East, to Bahrain, you know, and was working very hard. So someone asked him, "The Middle East has extreme weather, too much cold, too much heat. How do you tolerate it?" So he said, "Because the value of dinar is much more than Indian currency. Because I'm making a lot of money here, I'm able to tolerate." Because he's thinking that my mission in life is to earn. So therefore, I'm tolerating all the difficulties. Therefore, when our mission in life is great, something big, we are ready to tolerate the small difficulties that come on the way. And the question is, do we want to get purified? Srila Prabhupada would ask this to his disciples when there would be struggles, like in this Juhu land. This is a very beautiful example. When our Juhu temple was being made in Bombay, now it's a grand temple, but in those days in the 1970s, it was like a place, a rat infested place, full of mosquitoes, very difficult place to stay. But devotees were somehow struggling and staying, that there was not even a proper house, in a place where they had made a small temporary house, a temporary rack, there the devotees were staying there. So Prabhupada and Giriraj Maharaj once, who was the temple president of the Juhu land there, he went and told Srila Prabhupada, I want to leave this place. I want to go to America and preach there. Prabhupada asked him one question. Do you want to get purified? He said, yes. He said, I want to get purified, definitely. Then you stay here and tolerate the difficulties. And because Giriraj Maharaj stayed there and tolerated all the difficulties of Bombay life, he's got such mercy of Srila Prabhupada and Krishna, such a successful guru, and now he's written that book. The story of the struggle of the Juhu land is actually come out in the form of a glorious book. So the point is this question, do we want to get purified? If you want to get purified, then we need to tolerate. Vacho vegam manasa krodha vegam jiva vegam udar upastha vegam etan vegan yo vishahet dhira sarvam api maam sa prithvim sa shishyat. Rupa Goswami in his Nectar of Instruction, the first verse, he says, when we tolerate all these urges, the urge of the mind, the urge of anger, the urge of the senses, belly, these are all urges. It's difficult to tolerate. When the senses tell you, I want this to enjoy, when the mind tells you, I want this to enjoy, to tolerate all that is very difficult. But when we keep tolerating it, understanding that this is for the pleasure of Krishna, then we can actually become successful. Therefore, Krishna says in Gita 5.23, Shaknoti heva yashodum praksharira vimokshanat. I forgot the next two lines. So Krishna basically says that Sa yukta sa suki nara. So Krishna says, one who tolerates all the urges of the body, the kaam vasana, the krodh vasana, till the fag end of life, such a person can actually become happy and liberated. So how to develop tolerance? By actually taking shelter of Krishna. By actually taking shelter of Krishna. That is why Kunti Maharani, she prays to Krishna, my dear Krishna, I don't want a life of no problems. In fact, give me problems so that I can take shelter of you. So in this world, whatever we see is an opportunity to surrender to Krishna. COVID is an opportunity to surrender to Krishna. Cyclone is an opportunity to surrender to Krishna. Good times, bad times, honor, dishonor, heat, cold, everything is an opportunity to surrender to Krishna. Maro bhi rako bhi jo iccha tuhar, Krishna dasa prati tuma adhikar. So one of our acharya says, oh my dear Krishna, whether you save me or kill me, maro bhi rako bhi jo iccha tuhar, whether I am, I stay alive through this COVID phase or I pass away, whatever you wish, Krishna. Krishna dasa prati tuva adhikar. Because I am your servant, whatever you wish, you can do with me. Right? That is your adhikar. So therefore, devotees in good times, bad times, they use every time to take shelter of Krishna. Like Bhakti Vinod Thakur says, Suke duke bule nako vadane harinam bolo re. In good times or bad times, in any time, don't forget to chant Hare Krishna. So this is a war against Maya. Right? So we are all against with a war against Maya, and Maya is trying to attack us in so many ways, trying to tempt us in so many ways. Sometimes honor, sometimes dishonor. Like Srila Prabhupada would say, Krishna tested me twice. One time by taking everything away. I told you the story. Prabhupada lost Bose laboratory, everything away. And second time, Prabhupada said, Krishna gave everything to me. ISKCON became very successful. And in both times, both were tests of Krishna, right? Because when everything is taken away, when you go through bad times, your faith in Krishna may shake and you may just give up bhakti. And when everything is great in life, you may forget Krishna. Right? So we are against a war against Maya. So therefore, we need to focus on our bhakti with great integrity and keep continuing on and on. So when we practice this virtue of tolerance like this, the result Krishna guarantees is, in next sloka that we will see the next time, is that we can actually achieve liberation. So this is the path to liberation, by tolerating whatever situations come in life. Thank you very much. Anyone has any questions? No questions.
Hare Krishna Prabhu.
Yeah.
Actually, in this material world, actually we have this three types of miseries, Prabhu. Adhyatmik, Adhidevik, Adhibhautik.
Yeah, correct.
This natural calamities is the Adhidevik. Other living entities is Adhibhautik. Adhyatmik is body and mind. How to tolerate, Prabhu, all of these natural calamities we are not under control? What about other living entities and the body and mind?
Nothing is under our control. So
even not... body and mind also we can control now, Prabhu.
Yeah, but how much can you control? If one COVID enters your body, what can you control? You know, you don't have so much control, right? So mind, yeah, how much control we do have? Definitely we should try our best, you know. It's not that we don't do our responsibility, but the point is, in this world nothing is so much under the control. So as devotees, our idea of mind control is, Krishna, you help me control my mind, you help me, right? So that is our understanding. So when we actually chant Hare Krishna, one thing we will definitely realize, we will realize that I am not that great. I was thinking I have mind control, but my mind is not so much under my control. And that's a good realization. When we realize that, we will actually surrender to Krishna, that Krishna, my mind is not under my control. Like Bhaktivinoda Thakur in that Gopinath bhajan, he says, Manute pagala, na mane shashana. He says, my mind is mad, it doesn't listen to me. Therefore, Krishna, you control it. So that is our mood. We definitely try our best, but even when we're trying our best is not enough, we surrender to Krishna. That Krishna, you help me. So that humility and that surrender actually is a great blessing. And then our process of bhakti actually begins and Krishna's mercy comes. Yeah, I don't know what exactly your question was. I don't know whether I answered it. Yeah. Explain the three points of tolerance. I explained many points actually. Okay, I'll tell you all what the points are, some points. So we tolerate people. How do you tolerate people? So as I told you, tolerance is like a long topic. There are so many things that we need to tolerate. So tolerating people, like Sharmila Mataji is asking, how to tolerate in family? Three things. First, focus on the good in people. Second, try to neglect the bad. And third is cultivate appreciation, which is very, very important. You know, speak good about them. Try to cultivate appreciation about them. Right? So in this way, we can tolerate in a family, right? Tolerating people. How do you tolerate criticism? Again, three things. First is, see this as an opportunity to improve. That person is giving me feedback so that I can improve. Second is, he's giving me feedback so that I can be careful in the future. Even if I'm not doing the mistake now, he's telling me to be careful in the future. And the third is, this is an opportunity for me to take shelter of Krishna, because this person is criticizing me because probably in my last life I have done something to him, so that karma is coming back to me. So Krishna is telling me to become humble and surrender. You know, so this person is actually making me humble, because if everyone glorifies us and speaks nice about us, who will make us humble? So someone makes us humble. So in this way, we can actually tolerate criticism. And then we discussed also tolerating duality. How do you tolerate duality, happiness, distress, all that? First thing is to realize that the nature of this world is dukkalayam ashashvatam. So when difficulties come, you understand that ye dunya ka rule hai, aane wala hi hai. So you're ready for it, mentally ready. So when you're mentally ready for something, it becomes easy to manage. Second is reconcile the fact that it will pass away. Nothing is going to remain permanent. So therefore, in Swarga Loka, there is too much happiness. In Naraka Loka, there is too much distress. But in the earthly realm, in Bhuloka, happiness and distress are almost equal. Right? So that means you can't say that I am too much in distress. No, you will get happiness also. And you can't say that I am too happy. I'm experiencing too much happiness. You will get distress also. So reconcile the fact that it will pass away. And third is, repent the fact that because we came in this world, all this is happening. If we didn't come in this world and if we didn't have a body, where is the question of COVID? Because we came in this world, we have to face COVID and all this. If we didn't come here only, everything would have been good. So now that we have come here, we have made a mistake. Let us repent sincerely. And with that repentance, when we actually chant Hare Krishna and pray to Krishna, Krishna, Iha samsare bahu dushtare kripaya pahe pahe murare. Punarapi jananam, punarapi maranam, punarapi janare jatare shayanam. Shankaracharya prays, Krishna, you know, we have to take repeated birth and death. But then I'm fed up of the cycle. I want to surrender unto you. Bhajagovindam, bhajagovindam, bhajagovindam mudamate. So when we surrender unto Krishna like this, I am somehow fallen in this ocean of birth and death, like Chaitanya Mahaprabhu prays in the Shikshashtakam. So kindly pick me up and make me a dust particle at your lotus feet. You know, then actually we can get rid of all the problems. So as I told you, we can see all this as an opportunity when difficulties come in life, you know, when dishonor comes in life, whatever comes in life, we can see that as an opportunity to actually surrender to Krishna. Yeah.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Yeah. Okay. This Adhyatmika miseries due to our past life baggage and this life's reaction for our action.
Yeah, you're talking about misery due to body and mind, huh?
Yes, yes.
Correct? Yeah, it's all due to our karma only. Previous life karma, this life karma, all that baggage. Correct. So someone's mind is little more peaceful, someone's mind is agitating. Yeah.
Yeah. So we somebody can prepare for our next life.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. Next life means in spiritual world. I mean, no more material life.
Yes, yes. We don't have to come here.
Yes. So COVID can be a great. So COVID can be a great motivating thing for us. Krishna is telling us, you want to be permanently freed from COVID, then don't come here, because in this world, viruses like this will always be there.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so let's stop here. Before we end, one quick announcement. See, we have started this morning japa session, 5:45 till 7. We are doing this Zoom japa on Zoom. So it's been going on for a week now. So quite a few devotees join in. So if you all can join, I don't know whether the timing works out for you all. It may not work out for everyone. But if you all can join, you all can join. Right. So,
what is the link, Prabhuji? Hare Krishna, Prabhuji, what is the link?
There's one link. We will send it in the group. There is only one link that's there every day. So we'll put it in the group now. That same is there every day. We put it in that group, Prabhuji. Okay? So if you all can, please try to join in. So it's a nice chance for those who join in. Okay. Let's end for today. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.